Friends, we have gathered here to praise God and to witness to our faith as we celebrate the life of Virginia Latshaw Wilson. We come together in grief, acknowledging our human loss. May we sense Virginia's spirit among us as we pray, tell stories, sing, and share in a time of fellowship following the service. May God grant us grace that in pain we may find comfort, in sorrow, hope, and in death, resurrection. Music was an important part of Virginia's life, so we're going to sing a number of hymns. And I invite you to join first in hymn number 64, Holy, Holy, Holy. Eternal God, we praise you for the great company of all those who have finished their course in faith and now rest in their labor. We praise you for those dear to us whom we name in our hearts before you. Especially we pray for Virginia, whom you have graciously received into your presence. To all of these, grant your peace. Let perpetual light shine from them. Help us so to believe that your presence may lead us through our years as we build your kingdom together with those who have gone before. Amen. Hear these words from the Gospel according to John. Jesus said to them, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry. Whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. But I say to you that you have seen me and yet do not believe. Everything that the Father gives me will come to me, and anyone who comes to me I will never drive away. For I have come down from heaven, not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me. And this is the will of him who sent me, that I should lose nothing of all that he has given me, but raise it up on the last day. This is indeed the will of my Father, that all who see the Son and believe in him may have eternal life, and I will raise them up on the last day." Let us sing together Amazing Grace, number 378.
Thank you.
amazing grace. That's what we experience today as we celebrate the life of Virginia. We experience God's outpouring of love for her and for us. It is as Virginia would have wanted it, out of her upbringing by a liberal Mennonite father and a Lutheran mother. And as we have sung, we have expressed the faith that Virginia expressed in so many ways. For her, it came vividly through music. Beginning on piano, she moved to pipe organ in high school. She found joy in music. But in her interest in doing it right, she always had the music in front of her. For a number of years, she was in the organ rotation in this church for the early service of worship on Sundays, which incorporated both piano and traditional organ. While I was on staff here, I was invited to preach at the Little LC United Methodist Church one summer Sunday, and I discovered that there was to be no musician there. So I invited Virginia to go along with me and be the musician that Sunday morning. Through her, we made the service whole. Virginia worked at making many things whole. Howard certainly furthered our shared graduate program at the University of Illinois. It was in mathematics, and even though they approached mathematics differently, he from the standpoint of logic and she from memorizing the formulas, they found each other and made each other whole. They were married in 1960 as they completed that time in Illinois, and then they ventured to Eastern Oregon, a long way from those Pennsylvania roots on the egg farm. Virginia continued her career as a high school or junior high math teacher, which she had begun in her home state of Pennsylvania. When Cheryl joined the family, Virginia focused on being a mother and spending a lot of time typing Howard's doctoral dissertation, 6 times. You've got to give her a lot of credit. Randy and Ryan brought additional joys to motherhood, and her goal was to make their home home. She gardened, she cooked, she did handwork, sewing, and tailoring. Howard had made a commitment that if he brought Virginia to Oregon, then his summer vacation from the university would include trips to Pennsylvania, and they ventured back annually. The trips in the car were made fun by surprise boxes that Virginia prepared for the kids, and the many songs they sang along the way. These children allowed the children to connect with their grandparents and extended family. Son Brian says that he kind of wondered sometimes when they were in Pennsylvania because he always had trouble understanding his grandfather and thought it was because he mumbled. Then Brian says, quote, "In 1985, I was a senior in high school and our family went to see the movie Witness together, which was partly about Amish people in Pennsylvania, right around where my mother grew up. And in the movie is a barn raising scene where the Amish speak to each other in German. I'm sitting next to Mom, and she perks up and starts translating what they are saying. I was completely shocked and confused by this development in my world. It was like I didn't even know my own mother. After the movie, her story came out something like this. Growing up, she spoke Pennsylvania Dutch and German dialect in her home with her parents. But when she started attending public school, she was ashamed of her accent and began speaking exclusively English and hiding her language skills, so that even when her parents talked to her in German, she answered in English." End quote. Brian says this led him to the revelation that his grandfather was not mumbling, but had a strong German accent, and that his mother had an ability he has envied all his life, that of being bilingual. Now for me, speaking any language and mathematics makes one bilingual. So to my mind, Virginia was trilingual. After Cheryl, Randy, and Brian were launched, Virginia returned to work. For a time, she worked at OSU and then returned to her love of teaching math, at Lynn-Benton Community College this time. She excelled at finding ways of communicating with those for whom math was truly a foreign language. She taught only half-time, but from what I hear of her commitment to correcting papers meticulously far into the night, I think half-time merely described the classroom time and the pay, and not the time she was spending. She retired from Lynn-Benton in 1994. Retirement allowed more time at the coast, Virginia's favorite place, and time to explore other new destinations. Virginia and Howard purchased a spot in Palm Springs where they soaked up the sun each winter. They traveled on riverboats on the Erie Canal and the Danube. They traveled by train from China. They visited Hawaii's Big Island. While Virginia struggled at times to find the bright spots in life, she created many bright spots for others. As we sang earlier in the service, "Lord God Almighty, all thy works shall praise thy name." It was in this belief that Virginia lived her life. Out of this belief, she sought ways to bring wholeness to the community. She was a regular volunteer at the OSU Folk Club Thrift Shop. She was active here in United Methodist Women. There are many who have been a part of this congregation who have felt that Virginia made things whole for them. She was for several years a member of the congregational care team and was among those who visited persons who were homebound in care centers or just released from the hospital to make connections with this worshiping community, provide meals, transportation, and friendly conversation. Virginia's ready smile and the sparkle in her eye endeared her to those she visited. And in recent years, those same qualities were a joy to those who visited Virginia. It is the amazing grace of God that has allowed us to share life with Virginia, to know what it is to be made whole through God's love, and to know that we are able to carry on her legacy as she lived that amazing grace for others. Virginia's sister, Carol, sent me some memories that she asked that I share today. When I was born, Virginia was 13. She and my other sister, Miriam, helped care for me. Ginny, I had never heard her called Ginny, and Howard, I don't know. Did you call her Ginny? No, he says. Ginny was like a mother to me. She was kind and considerate, encouraging and positive. When something bothered me, I could talk to her about it. Some of my favorite childhood memories include her. I remember many of our family gathered around the piano to sing Christmas songs while Ginny played. In the summer, I remember my sisters, my brother David, and me going to Bensky Miniature Golf Course and reading with Ginny driving. Another favorite outing was the Dorney Amusement Park in Allentown, and Ginny was along with the rest of the family. She was the firstborn in our family and was a leader in several ways for my siblings and me. She took piano lessons. We all took piano lessons. She went to college. We all went to college. When Jenny went to college, we saw less of her. After graduation, she taught high school near Paoli, Pennsylvania for 3 years. I admired her stylish dressing and her confidence in speaking with a variety of people. After she got her master's degree in Illinois, she and Howard married and moved to Oregon. She faithfully wrote letters once a week to mother and dad. Each August, she and Howard and their family drove back to Pennsylvania to visit. We always looked forward to that. In later years, my husband Wade and I started visiting Ginny and Howard in California, where they spent winters. We got to know them better, and we took 3 trips together with them. How we enjoyed our time together. We saw Jenny and Howard a year and a half ago when we visited them in Corvallis. Jenny was outgoing. Her care and nurture, nature and empathy were intact. I felt this was part of her essence, so to speak, throughout her lifetime. I felt blessed that Jenny was a part of my life and that we had a close relationship despite the difference in our ages and the distance we lived from each other. There are other friends and family who will be speaking, and I would invite them to come at this time, and they will introduce themselves to me.
She was a wonderful person, a wonderful friend, and I will I'm a captain and chef's mother. When my family sat down to brainstorm the memories of Virginia, we had a hard time. It wasn't because we could remember things about her. How she would take us with her kids to the dinosaur bone park, or as the grown-ups call it, a reaper here in Corvallis. How she always had fresh flowers to the vase. The picnics outside of her on the military tablecloth. Not to mention her delicious shoe bacon. We had a hard time because all of our memories were about our experience. How happy we were. Not just about her, but about us. Which, if you think about it, is exactly what Virginia would have wanted. Virginia was not one to draw attention to herself. In fact, she was always amazingly good at deflecting any attention that was brought to her. When you would ask her how she was doing, she would answer, "Oh, fine," and then be quick to turn it around and ask you how you were doing. She would always ask this with a genuine care for and interest in how you answered. Virginia was a loving grandmother. She was so happy to be a grandma. And I think it's safe to say that all of her grandchildren had a special place in her heart. She always had activities planned to do with her grandchildren, like going to concerts in the park, shopping at the OSU thrift store, visiting the coast, or playing in the sandbox at their house. Breakfasts with grandma were always complete with homemade granola and honey and Cheerios. We loved playing with old barn set and dollhouse that she kept in her house and mom's old apartments. We would have picnics and explore the property that she grew up lived on, and it's safe to say that visits to Grandma Wilson's house were never lacking in fun things to do. Virginia was also a loving mother. She cared for her children more than anything. Cheryl, her daughter, remembers her mother giving her piano lessons, pretty dresses, and a little bedroom. Virginia took a cake decorating class and would make themed cakes for the birthday parties that she threw for her children. There was always a cooler packed full of sandwiches and snacks on those long summer road trips that they would take back home. This love was extended to Mark, Ramey, and Catherine as they joined her. Virginia was always doing something. I am sure her children will remember how busy she would stay at their homes during her visits, doing odd jobs like scrubbing the stove, mending clothes, ironing pillowcases, or calling weeds. Her son-in-law, Mark, remembers coming out to the dining room of his house and seeing Virginia painting the light fixtures in the kitchen. Virginia was always asking, "What can I do to help?" and genuinely wanted. This attitude of being a giver was always something that we loved and appreciated about Virginia. But it wasn't until Cheryl became a mother herself that she realized just how much she appreciated this attribute. When Cheryl was a new mom, she shares that when Virginia would come visit, Virginia would wake up early and in the middle of the night to care for Cheryl's children so that Cheryl could get some rest. We will always remember how happy Virginia was when she would pick fresh fruit for her learner. Cheryl says she would smile as she picked the fruit and say, "They're just too beautiful to stop." We'll remember her very, very popular with those delicious Oregon berries, her butter beans, the Pennsylvania Dutch pork roast, and can I say again the shoelet pie? We'll also remember her willingness to help with anything that you needed. These are the things that we will remember about Virginia. But we will most of all remember who she was, a loving, helpful, giving, and empathetic woman that we will miss dearly.
Virginia's tireless work ethic to do what was expected as a mother, wife, sister, daughter, grandmother, church member, and community member. Her days were filled with endless tasks in providing a well-stocked kitchen, homemade jams, frozen applesauce, and berries to last the year, satiated stomachs from the brief food room, a meticulously clean home, weekly calls to her sister, father, and volunteering at the church and at the third store. While Virginia always did what was expected, I also came to realize that helping people was truly one of the things that made her happy. At her core, Virginia was the embodiment of selflessness, always compassionate and understanding, with a keen ability to see a situation from the other person's perspective. She was the most loving, gentle, and genuinely good-hearted person I've been blessed to know. Thanks, Mom was also very talented, something I didn't really see until later in life. I don't know how many of you can see the organ console up here, but I don't know how many of you have walked up to it and considered trying to play with it. It's got a couple of keyboards, a bunch of stops, various pedals down below, and another keyboard for your feet. And she, both through skill and a lot of practice, played this at a bunch of church services here in this beautiful sanctuary through the years and at other places. She also managed our family's home through the years, including a move to Papua New Guinea and back. Being a homemaker is often taken for granted, but pretty impressive. Mom was a great cook, as people have mentioned. She mostly liked to cook from recipes, but when she was presented with 100 pounds of gamey moose meat brought back from an Alaskan hunt, she was able to improvise to hide the taste from three picky teenagers. Well, mostly. And through it all, she raised three happy kids. Mom was amazing. I should have told her that, so every day. I think Virginia was mostly known for being cooperative and helpful, but she was also driven by a strong moral code that she imparted on us. As a small example, when you were picking strawberries, you could only eat a couple to be fair to the farmer. Mom saw cooking as a moral duty. As she explained, growing up on a farm, she learned it was the woman's responsibility to provide nourishing food for the family, and she took that responsibility seriously. On the sterner side, Mom caught me swearing and washed my mouth out with soap. Two times. I guess I was a slow learner. How many people know what soap tastes like? I guess you guys were bad too. And one time in senior year of high school, I went to a party, and the next morning I was lying in bed with a bad hangover. Mom came into the room and said, "Randy?
Yeah?
Are you okay?"
"Not really."
"Does it hurt?"
"Yes."
"Good." And she walked out. Mom was famous for empathy, but I think she also saw a lesson to be taught. Like many kids, I didn't say thanks enough. "Mom, thanks for being there at band concerts and church events when I needed a shoulder to cry on. Thanks for 18 years times 52 weeks times 7 days times 2 to 3 meals a day. And thanks for patiently teaching me to cook. To butcher a saying, cook your son about 19,000 meals and he'll eat till he's a man. Teach him how to cook and he'll be able to feed his family. Thanks for trying to help me with my girlfriend, Charles. Thanks for forcing me to take 2 years of piano before drums, and then for putting up with my drums for 8 years. Thanks for always being there at too many mundane situations to list, but all of them meaningful. You were so reliable that we all took you for granted. Thank you." I've mentioned my mom's cooking several times, and other people have too, but I Jacob, my son, is her apple cake. My family can't decide whether her chief white eye is sand and blue or a game changer, but it's an institution either way. So why am I going on and on about mom's desserts? Because in a way, they're like Virginia herself. Like her desserts, mom was simple in the best way. You always knew she was trying her best. She didn't have her own agenda, she just wanted to help you. She and her desserts gathered strength from her community. It came from her mom, Florence, from dad's mom, Irma, Betty Crocker, friends from church, and 4F, some of whom are here. Mom and her desserts hailed back to an honest, personal time when you made what was in season and plentiful and fresh, before the eat local fad and you made it stylish. Mom wasn't into fads, but like her desserts, she was reliably good. She was always sweet and warm. She served us dessert like she served us in so many other ways. She and her desserts were always nourishing to our bodies and souls and our waistlines. Thanks for all the desserts, Mom. Thanks for everything. I'll miss you. Well, I'll miss you.
Please turn to hymn number 700 and sing together if I have a theme.
Thank you.
holy God, we live in mystery and paradox, life and death, tears and laughter, fire and water, tragedy and blessing weave in and out of our lives. So much is a mystery, yet so much bears your grace. You hold us, this world, and our loved ones in your tender embrace. We turn to you in our trust that you have welcomed Virginia into your heavenly community, where she is embraced by your love. We turn to you in our grief and know that we are not left alone. We are surrounded by the prayer and care of friends, the communion of saints, and the signs and symbols of this holy place. We know there is one who knows our pain, feels our loss, dries our tears, and walks with us the valleys of grief. We know there is a love that is stronger than death. So at this time and in this place, we believe that Virginia and we are held in the arms of grace, uplifted on the wings of hope, sustained by the words of prayer, cared for in surprising ways. We entrust Virginia to your never-failing love and ourselves to your ever-present care. In the name of the one who showed us your love beyond all measure and who taught us to pray, singing.
Help us to be kind to those who are hard to be kind to. And help us, Father, to honor her memory by serving one another and thinking of other people as more important than you are. Father, we thank you for Virginia and for the fact that she loved to be here and she loved music and she loved her family. She loved her husband and she loved to help other people. Father, it is a great thing when we see those who on earth reflect your Son, Jesus Christ, for we know that Jesus Christ was also a great servant as we read your scriptures. We pray, Father, that as we grieve, that we would be comforted, for you say in your word that you are a strong tower and that you will hold your people in the shadow of your wing. We pray, Father, that we would seek you and that we would find comfort in your Son, Jesus Christ, for in him there is comfort and there are pleasures forevermore. We thank you for this time together, and we pray that our fellowship after this would be a balm to our hearts, that we would enjoy one another's company, that we would enjoy one another's love, and that we would honor Virginia. And it's in the name of Jesus Christ I pray. Amen.
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 We stand as your Go with God.